back to another Commander Cast Short. My name is Andy, a.k.a. Ghosts with three O's, and this week Commander Cast Short is going to be similar to the first one, a bit of a strategy and technology segment, and this week I'm going to be covering the potential blind spot your deck might have with regards to Graveyard Hate. Now, why is Graveyard Hate important to include in any deck in EDH? There's a lot of reasons for this, but the more developed your metagame is, the more likely it is that you're going to have players abusing the graveyard. And just part of the nature of the format is that many of the most powerful strategies do abuse the graveyard. Many of the most powerful strategies that you're going to see are based around recursion, either for combos or to just get back really powerful spells and cast them repeatedly until a player wins the game. Reanimation, flashback spells, and incarnations are also serious questions in EDH that your deck should be prepared to have an answer for. Now, one problem with Graveyard Hate is that a lot of people consider many of the options symmetrical, so that makes running their own graveyard-based strategies more difficult. But there are enough options out there between artifacts and colored cards that enabled you to run an asymmetrical Graveyard Hate package. And now I'm going to go over a couple of cards that you can include in any deck, because they're colorless artifacts, that can compose the core of Graveyard Hate package. In colorless artifacts, we have four main cards to look at. Two are close to being a functional reprint. Firstly, we're going to look at Relic of Progenitus, recently printed. It's from Shards of Alara. This card is amazing, and I put it into just about every deck that I have. For two mana, you're able to completely nuke all of the graveyards. It's all exiled. And you also get to draw a card when you do this. So for two mana, that's an incredibly powerful effect, especially given that it's available to every single color combination with this card. The cycling also makes it a little more valuable because it's never a dead card. In a game where you're not sure the graveyard's going to be an important factor, or you know these decks and you know it's not going to be, you can still include it in your deck and it's never going to be a dead card. You can just pay two mana and cycle it out. It also has the ability to slowly digest your opponent's graveyard by tapping it. It lets them pick a card out of there, but that's never really the relic's primary function. It's not incorrect to play a relic early and keep your opponent off his graveyard by continually hosing him with that at the end of every turn before your own. But with relic, you have to be cagey about how you're going to play it, because if you know your opponents have powerful graveyard recursion strategies, then you can't just slap it down on the table, because the relic for this little innocuous one mana artifact becomes a target for all kinds of hate. That relic can result in some decks being completely blown out with one card, so it's going to be a priority target for destruction. As a result, you should really hold on to your relic until the time comes where you're actually going to want to use it to nuke all the graveyards. So this card isn't quite an auto-include because of the symmetry. It does exile every card in every graveyard. So if you're planning on using your own graveyard as a resource extensively, you have to be careful about how you're going to play it, or you're just going to have to look at alternatives that allow you to perform more asymmetrical graveyard hate. Now we're going to look at these two cards together because they're so functionally similar, Scrabbling Claws from Mirrodin and Phyrexian Furnace from Weatherlight. What they both do is they're both one mana artifacts, and you can tap them. In the case of Phyrexian Furnace, it removes the bottom card of an opponent's library from the game. And with Scrabbling Claws, they get to choose which card they want to remove from the game. They have one mana paid, and then you sacrifice them to draw a card. When you trigger this cantrip effect, you also get the bonus of being able to target a single card in a graveyard and exile it from the game. And this is the card's most powerful ability. Don't discount their ability to gradually chip away at your opponent's graveyards, but it's not as significant, because when you use that, these can effectively become a colorless counterspell for a lot of really powerful cards. Like if your opponent is endlessly recurring their Eternal Witness and getting their Time Warp back for infinite turns, then you're going to be able to take the Time Warp out of the game and they're going to be busted. That combo is broken. Now, with the Claws in the Furnace, you have to be careful because they have to be in play unless you have a way to flash them in to hose your opponent's graveyards. But they do have a little bit of a rattlesnake factor, because you can pay the one and sack them at any time to mess up one thing in a graveyard. So it kind of can create virtual card advantage when your opponents are refusing to cast Vigor Mortis or whatever they want on a large creature in the graveyard and bring it back into play, or they don't want their Mnemonic Wall to be targeting that big spell that they want back, because they know that you're just going to take it away. I find the Claws and the Furnace are good to go into any deck, unlike the Relic of Progenitus, because even if your own deck heavily relies on the graveyard as a resource, the pinpoint nature of these cards enables you to perform an asymmetrical maneuver, leaving your own resources intact. The last artifact that we're going to look at for Graveyard Hate packages that can go into any deck is Tormod's Crypt. This is a 0-mana artifact that was originally printed in the dark, but it was reprinted in Time Spiral. And you can tap it and sacrifice it to remove target player's graveyard from the game. This is a very effective one-shot card for defeating an opponent's graveyard and setting up things like an asymmetrical Twilight's Call. And removing all of the cards in an opponent's graveyards while leaving your own, that can be an extremely powerful move, especially if both of your decks are going to be using the graveyard as a resource. It's also 0 mana. Now, the disadvantage with Tormod's Crypt is that it doesn't replace itself, unlike some of these other graveyard hosing cards. And with the newly printed Nil Spellbomb, I find that's my preferred artifact for asymmetrical graveyard wiping in decks with the capacity to access black mana. But if you don't have access to black mana, you can always go back to the classics with Tormod's Crypt. So now that we've examined some cards that can go into any deck that you own, we'll investigate some of the more specific colored options that you might be able to put into your deck. When it comes to blue and red, you're kind of busted. They don't have a whole lot of options for dealing with graveyards. And while they do have some corner case options like Grip of Amnesia, which is a counterspell that can make your opponent remove their graveyard from the game, they're not necessarily great cards to put into an EDH deck. So if you're playing those two colors in conjunction, or a monocolored blue or red deck, you might have to just trust in your opponents to deal with graveyards and utilize those artifacts I mentioned earlier to the best that you can. Now, when we start looking at the other colors, I'm not going to go over every option available for each color, but I'll look at a couple of choice cards. We'll kick things off with green. Green has some capacity to deal with graveyards, not necessarily through the exiling route, but with shuffling things back into the library. I'm not going to go over every option available for each color, but I'll look at a couple of choice cards. So to start things off with green, we have Gaea's Blessing, which was originally printed in Weatherlight. Gaea's Blessing is a sorcery that lets you pick three target cards in a player's graveyard and shuffle them back into their deck. It's not a spectacular effect, but this card also has a unique secondary characteristic, where if it's milled into your graveyard, you get to shuffle your graveyard back into your deck. So it provides some unique utility, as well as the ability to hose graveyards. That said, it's a bit of a weak graveyard hoser, because it is sorcery speed. It is good at tucking generals that people like to put into their graveyard, like Child of Alara, back into their deck. So this is a unique, kind of quirky card you might want to put in their deck just because it provides you with a protection from milling anyway, if that's going to be pertinent to you, your deck plan, or in your metagame. Next in green, we have Krosan Reclamation, which is an instant from Judgment. And what this does is it lets you take two cards in an opponent's library and shuffle them back into their deck. And it also has Flashback. Now this is good because you get four cards out of their graveyard for the price of one card from your hand without having to use anything other than mana. It's not bad. It's also, like the Gaea's Blessing I just mentioned, excellent at sniping generals that are trying to be hidden in graveyards before they can be snuck back into play. But on the downside, Krosan Reclamation kind of has narrow applications. In EDH, it doesn't do a whole lot other than tuck nasty cards back into the library, which does make them harder to find in some cases, but it's also not as good as outright exiling them. Unless you're talking about generals, in which case this card is awesome. And it also is just doesn't do anything else. It doesn't cantrip. It doesn't have any other peripheral effects unlike Gaea's Blessing. So this is a corner case card, and depending how abused the graveyard is in your metagame, you might want to look at it a little more seriously. Otherwise, it's not one of my favorites, but I do run it in a few decks. And then finally for green, we have Ground Seal. It's an enchantment from Odyssey, and what it does is makes it so that cards in graveyards can't be the target of spells or abilities. Now, this isn't the most powerful graveyard hoser on the planet, because it still lets you play abilities that can be played directly from the graveyard, like Flashback. But that said, it does put the brakes on the most abusive strategies, which are, generally speaking, spell recursion and creature recursion, with things like Volrath's Stronghold, or Academy Ruins, or any number of reanimation spells. And as an additional bonus, it does cantrip, so it's never a dead card necessarily. It is really powerful at hosing strategies that are mono blue, mono red, or mono black, because they don't have efficient ways to remove enchantments. So if you have a deck that includes Chainer or Geth, and they're running out of control reanimating everything decent in a graveyard, playing Ground Seal can stop those decks cold. Now, on the downside with Ground Seal, it is a permanent that you have to put into play. So you're never going to have a surprise moment where your opponents are going to think, oh man, I just lost a card trying to target something in the graveyard. It's just not going to happen. And it's also nothing special in terms of getting rid of it. Any deck that's running a little bit of green or white can easily destroy it and just go right back to their previous strategy of recursion. That said, it is a fairly powerful effect, and you really have nothing to lose by running it since it does cantrip. And for the duration that it's there, it can really either stall or completely shut down certain decks based around recursion. Now moving on to white, we're going to look at three white cards, and I'm going to go from the most obvious to the most subtle. So starting with Morningtide, which is a rare from Torment, all this card does is remove all cards and graveyards from the game, and it's a sorcery. That's it. It's about as basic as it comes. On the plus side, it doesn't require you to put a permanent in play that can be destroyed before you can activate it, and you don't have to worry about tapping out with it in play. On the downside, it's a sorcery, so it's never going to have a surprise factor to it. And it also can lack the rattlesnake factor that cards like Relic of Progenitus or Phyrexian Furnace have. That said, I think it's a perfectly viable inclusion, especially if your opponents have gotten wise to these artifact cards, and they're generally not getting you anywhere. Now, in something a little bit more subtle, we have Stonecloaker. Stonecloaker is one of my favorite cards of all time. It's a creature from Planar Chaos that costs 3 mana. And when it comes into play, you have to return a creature card to your hand. It also exiles a card in a graveyard, and it's a 3/2 flyer. This guy does everything. In the context of this discussion, he does pinpoint removal in graveyards at instant speed because he does have flash, and then if you want to keep doing that, you can return him to your hand to pay that cost. Or, in the event of a Wrath and you want to save an important creature, you can return them and sacrifice the Stonecloaker. You can return an important blocking creature from a chump block situation to save them. He just does so many interesting and tricky things, and it's all at instant speed. Stonecloaker is fantastic, and I recommend including him in any white deck. His ability to snipe cards out of graveyards is really useful. But that said, as far as mass removing graveyard goes, it's one of the least efficient ways that you can find. So if he's going to be your only way to nuke graveyards, you really have to look at some of your other options like Relic of Progenitus, or even Mourning Tide since you're in white. And then, as the most subtle card out of the three white cards I'm talking about, we're going to take a brief look at Samurai of the Pale Curtain. This is a 2/2 white creature from the Kamigawa block with Bushido. It's double white, and whenever a permanent goes to the graveyard, you remove it from the game instead. Now, this effect isn't directly hating cards out of a graveyard in the context that we've been talking about before, but it does have the interesting effect of keeping permanents that your opponents want to repeatedly recur out of the graveyard. So it can slow these strategies down, or sometimes shut them down entirely, especially if they happen to lose those permanents, because if you play the Samurai of the Pale Curtain, and then say you destroy their mnemonic wall that they're repeatedly playing, well, they're not getting that mnemonic wall back because it's getting exiled. It's a bit trickier to use than the other cards we've been speaking about, but it can be a very powerful effect. Try it out for yourself and see how it works. Finally, we're going to discuss black, which is obviously the color with the most power to both abuse and negate the effect of your opponent's graveyards. So I'm not going to go over every option because black has so many, but we're going to give a quick nod to Nil Spellbomb, Suffer the Past, and Withered Wretch. Nil Spellbomb is like Tormod's Crypt, except it costs 2 mana and you're going to draw a card. But you have to pay black mana when you sacrifice it, so it can only be used in a black deck in EDH. This card is fantastic, not only because it has the redundancy of being an additional Tormod's Crypt, but it replaces itself unlike Tormod's Crypt. Now it has the same issues as Tormod's Crypt in that it is a permanent, you have to play it at sorcery speed generally speaking, but it is an asymmetrical effect, so I really suggest you give this a shot. You can probably get some copies from it from your local game store's garbage bin after a draft night. Next, we're going to look at Suffer the Past, which is an X spell from Rise of the Eldrazi. It's one black and X. And for each mana that you pay, you can remove a card in an opponent's graveyard from the game, and they lose one life, and you gain one life. And this is instant. This is one of the best graveyard-hating spells in a long time. It is mana intensive, but it's effectively a drain life. It's at instant speed, and it can act as a virtual counter spell when your opponent's trying to do something like reanimate a creature in a graveyard or recur a card in their graveyard. There's really no reason not to use this card if you're in black and you need something like a drain life effect as a mana dump, because the ability to use it at the end of turn lets you keep your mana open for other effects as well. And the ability to go through your opponent's card and individually pick out the cards you want to remove can be really powerful because it can completely gut your opponent's ability to use the recursion strategy. The final card we're looking at is Withered Wretch. It's 2 black for a 2/2, and you can pay 1 mana and exile a card in the graveyard from the game. It's simple, it's effective, and I think you should put it into pretty much any deck that can make black version. Now, to form a coherent graveyard hate package, just look at the available options and then pick the ones that fit your own game plan. If you need to use your own graveyard a great deal, turn to cards like Tormod's Crypt and targeted cards like Suffer the Past and Stonecloaker. And if you don't, then you're fine throwing with Relic of Progenitus and Ground Seal. Play to your strengths, but just be sure that your deck has some way to deal with recursion strategies, because you are going to run into them, and they are extremely powerful. That's all I have to say today on graveyard hate packages. Be sure to leave some comments if you have anything to add, or some cards of your own choice, maybe even some graveyard hate packages you run in your decks card for card. Be sure to hit us up at CommanderCast.com if you like what you're hearing, because we have more content there, including other videos and our weekly podcast.